In the previous chapter of our health section, we discussed the basics of protein and diet. In this chapter, we'll be discussing the relationship between animal protein and cancer. Dr. T. Colin Campbell from Cornell University, one of the most prominent figures of nutritional biochemistry, noted that an elevated intake of protein, particularly animal protein, is a risk factor for certain cancers, and that it promotes carcinogenesis. In this particular study, researchers from Berkeley and Cornell, including Dr. Campbell, delivered a liver carcinogen to rats and then fed those rats different amounts of animal protein. One group of the rats was fed a high protein diet containing 22% animal protein. The other group was fed a diet with only 6% protein. Again, all of the rats were first given the same liver carcinogen. It was observed at 100 weeks that most of the lower protein-fed rats were still alive and were healthier and thriftier in appearance, whereas many of the higher protein-fed rats were already dead or were severely burdened with tumors. The group with the highest animal protein intake, the 22%, developed the highest incidence of tumors. 90% of them developed tumors. They had the largest overall tumor mass, and they had 3 times higher prevalence of tumor metastases as compared with the group fed the lowest amount of protein in their diet. In another experiment, rats were similarly administered a carcinogen and then fed differing levels of animal protein. Specifically, the rats were given a liver carcinogen called aflatoxin. Then half were fed a diet containing 20% animal protein. As shown in the upper curve of this graph, that group exhibited the expected increased cancer development corresponding with the higher doses of the carcinogen they received. This is not surprising. The more carcinogen they were given, the more cancer they developed. But look what happened to the other half of the rats, who were instead fed a lower protein diet after being given the carcinogen. Cancer development did not increase for these rats as would have been expected with the increasing doses of the carcinogen they received. Decreasing the amount of animal protein in their diet almost made the cancer-producing substance stop having its cancer-producing effect. As the authors of the study put it, these data rather convincingly show that the growth and development of preneoplastic foci primarily occurs in response to the level of dietary casein, providing evidence that nutrient intake is more rate-limiting towards the development of these preneoplastic lesions than is the carcinogen dose. In other words, this study indicated that some cancer development may be controlled more by dietary protein levels than by exposure to the underlying carcinogen. These two studies that we just reviewed examined animal protein. But what about plant protein? Would it have the same effect on cancer development that animal protein has? The answer is no, it does not. When rats under the same conditions were similarly dosed with the same liver carcinogen, but then fed diets with plant protein instead of animal protein, they did not exhibit the same increased cancer development, even when they were given diets with high levels of plant protein after being dosed with a carcinogen. The study found that the rats fed a 20% plant protein diet after being dosed with a carcinogen exhibited far less cancer development than rats fed with 20% animal protein. Again, all of the rats were dosed with the same liver carcinogen, but the rats fed a high animal protein diet exhibited the high levels of cancer development, while the rats fed a high plant protein diet did not. The conclusion of this and similar studies is that large amounts of animal protein enhance cancer growth, enhance tumor growth, while large amounts of plant protein do the opposite. The studies we've reviewed so far are based on experiments conducted on rats. However, it is important to note that extrapolating results from animal experiments can be problematic for a number of reasons, not the least of which is the underlying biological differences between humans and non-humans. As a general matter, we do not support the use of animals or non-consenting humans in biomedical experiments, which we'll discuss further in a separate chapter under our ethics section. However, we still believe it is important to include these studies here in our health section, since they have nonetheless contributed to the medical literature examining the links between animal protein and cancer. While these animal experiments are compelling, they may not have been altogether necessary given the extensive number of human studies that have been conducted as well. As we begin to review those studies on this topic, we need to start with one factor that in particular appears to contribute to the association between animal protein and cancer. It's a hormone called insulin-like growth factor 1, or IGF-1. IGF-1 promotes cell growth in both normal and cancer cells. For this reason, high levels of IGF-1 are associated with higher levels of carcinogenesis. This hormone appears to be nutritionally regulated, and having animal protein in our body from our diet results in higher levels of this cancer-promoting hormone. This study, published in the Journal of Cancer Epidemiology Biomarkers of Prevention, noted that consumption of animal protein was associated with increased levels of IGF-1. As mentioned earlier, IGF-1 is a hormone that stimulates cell proliferation and inhibits cell death. Because cell proliferation is what cancer is all about, higher levels of IGF-1 have been associated with various types of cancer. This study further notes that, in particular, restriction of protein rich in essential amino acids substantially reduces IGF-1 production in vitro and in vivo. The protein that is rich in these amino acids is animal protein, or meat, fish, poultry, eggs, and dairy. Although plant protein also contains all of the essential amino acids, it is animal protein that has the higher proportion of these amino acids, and that is what has been shown to increase levels of IGF-1, and as previously reviewed in the earlier cited study, is associated with increased cancer development. The aim of this cross-sectional study was to determine whether a plant-based vegan diet is associated with lower circulating levels of IGF-1 compared with a meat-eating or lacto-ovo-vegetarian diet. This study found that IGF-1 levels were 13% lower in vegans than in meat eaters or lacto-ovo-vegetarians. So dropping meat, poultry, and fish while continuing to eat eggs and dairy, which is what lacto-ovo-vegetarians do, did not produce the drop in this cancer-promoting hormone as we see in vegans. The study concludes that this data suggests that a plant-based diet is associated with lower circulating levels of total IGF-1, which may explain the correlation between animal protein and cancer risk. In another study published in the British Journal of Cancer, IGF-1 was found to be 9% lower in vegan men compared to meat eaters. And men who developed prostate cancer were found to have an 8% level of IGF-1, higher level of IGF-1, than those who remained healthy. This suggests that the 9% difference observed in vegan men was large enough to significantly alter prostate cancer risk. Perhaps that's why other medical reviews, like this one in this cancer journal, suggest that diets high in dairy and meats are related to higher risk of prostate cancer incidence or mortality in most ecologic, case control, and prospective studies. This study was published in the Journal of Urology and involved institutions including UCSF, UCLA, and Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, which is one of the leading cancer centers in the United States. It explored the effect of diet changes on the progression of prostate cancer with men who had early biopsy-proven prostate cancer. Some of these men were randomly assigned to an experimental group that was put on a vegan diet. The remaining men comprised the control group and continued their traditional Western diet. After 1 year, they drew blood from both the vegan group and the control group and found that the blood from the vegan group was almost 8 times more potent at inhibiting the growth of cancer cells compared to the blood of the non-vegan control group. As shown in this graph, the blood from the vegan group inhibited cancer cell growth by 70%, compared to only 9% for the non-vegan control group. One additional footnote to this study is that 6 of the men from the non-vegan control group withdrew from the study to undergo conventional treatment due to an increase in prostate-specific antigen levels or progression of their prostate cancer. In contrast, no experimental group patient who were put on a vegan diet underwent conventional treatment during the study. Quite similarly, with respect to breast cancer, this study in the Journal of Endocrine Reviews describes how systemic administration of IGF-1 causes mammary hyperplasia, or proliferation of the cells in the breast glands, and that the overproduction of IGF-1 can cause the development of breast cancer. Even small changes in diet can have a profound impact on health. As published in the International Journal of Cancer, this multi-centered study on diet and bladder cancer found that a 3% increase in the consumption of energy from animal protein was associated with a 15% higher risk of cancer, whereas a 2% increase in energy from plant protein intake was associated with a 23% lower risk of cancer. It is quite remarkable that such a small amount of animal protein consumption is associated with such a correspondingly large increase in cancer risk, while the opposite is shown with regard to consumption of plant protein. It has been known for some time that plant proteins may reduce the risk of cancer, obesity, and cardiovascular risk. With regard to cancer, this review notes that high IGF-1 activity associated with heavy ingestion of animal products may be largely responsible for the epidemic of Western cancers in wealthy societies. An unnecessarily high intake of essential amino acids may prove to be a grave risk factor for Western degenerative diseases, as is excessive fat intake. In general, vegan proteins tend to contain a higher fraction of the non-essential amino acids than the main animal-derived proteins do, dietary proteins do. The basic thesis for this review is that animal protein, precisely because of its so-called high-quality protein rich in essential amino acids, will upregulate IGF-1 activity and thereby act as a cancer promoter, whereas so-called low-quality vegan proteins can be expected to have the opposite effect. So basically, what is referred to as high-quality protein, which simply refers to the higher concentration of essential amino acids in animal food, would be more appropriately labeled high-risk instead. This large, multi-centered cohort study, published in the British Journal of Cancer, compare the incidence of cancer in people following different diets, noting that meat has been suspected of influencing the risk for several types of cancer. The study included over 60,000 men and women on various types of diets and followed them for an average of 12 years. They found that vegetarians had a decreased risk of several cancers, including a statistically significant 64% risk reduction for stomach cancer, over 40% risk reduction for lymphatic and blood cancers, 43% less risk for non-Hodgkin lymphoma, and a 75% risk reduction for multiple myeloma. The authors of the study noted that the most striking finding was a relatively low risk for cancers of the lymphatic and hematopoietic tissues among vegetarians. Another large cohort study was conducted across 10 European countries and published in the International Journal of Cancer, called EPIC for the European Prospective Investigation into Cancer and Nutrition. The study found that a high intake of poultry was related to an increased risk of B-cell lymphomas. While the study refers to a high intake, it's really not talking about that much poultry at all, considering that it found a 22% increased risk of this cancer per just 10 grams of poultry intake. Keep in mind that a single chicken breast is about 85 grams or more. That was poultry. Now this is about red meat. Yet another review of two large-scale cohort studies involving almost 40,000 men and over 80,000 women examined the links between red meat and mortality. It concluded that red meat consumption is associated with an increased risk of total cardiovascular disease and cancer mortality. Substitution of other healthy protein sources for red meat is associated with lower mortality risk. So overall, what general conclusions can we make? Well, while diet is not the only risk factor for cancer, the strong association between animal protein and cancer development should not be ignored. And it is a modifiable risk factor that can easily be avoided by simply changing one's diet, as this 2013 peer-reviewed cancer research article puts it. Vegan diets showed statistically significant protection for overall cancer incidence.